Hi, Saruni, can you ask her to come, please? No. She has to join now. Yeah. Hi, Guru, can you hear me? Okay, I think you need to unmute. Yeah, better. Can you hear me now?
Can you hear me? Am I muted?
Yes, I can. Perfect, perfect. So we can hear each other. Welcome, Gulpanak, to yet another edition of Time Pass. Thank you so much for coming on board today at such short notice.
Thank you for having
and
me.
And we're very excited about Patal Lok. And we're very excited about Patal Lok on Amazon Prime. It's looking really good, huh? Talk a little about your role there.
I play Hathiram Chaudhary's wife, Renu. She is a housewife who's sort of made her peace with the fact that her husband's career is not going anywhere because
right.
He sort of lives through him, right? I mean, that socioeconomic strata of women are sort of destined to fulfill their aspirations through the careers of their husbands and what happens with their lives. So Hathiram's career is really not going anywhere. And she sort of made her peace with it. And she's trying to find the best of what she can make out of a pretty much grim situation. She's the one bright spark in the gloom that tends to surround Hathiram on most days. So she tries to keep the family together. Her son is struggling because they put him in a school that's way out of their league socially. She's just trying to hold the family together and do her very best to make the best out of what is not the best situation as she would have imagined it to be.
And Hathiram is a sort of middling police constable, sort of muddling through life, right?
So he's the quintessential cop who's just sort of nondescript. Hmm. I mean, he's not a star cop like who's going to go out there and change the world. He's not fighting the system. He, in fact, is a victim of the system, which doesn't really give you very many chances, to be fair. So, the system doesn't really give you that many chances in reality. And if you don't take that one opportunity that comes your way and a case goes wrong, then it's pretty much downhill from there on.
Gul, it's so different from the characters you've played in the recent past, you know, really feisty, kick-ass women. You played this terrific gun-toting cop in The Family Man, and you were this very stylish gangster in Rang Baaz Phir Se. You really enjoyed those roles, didn't you?
I think they're a sort of an extension of my personality, not the gangster part, but a sort of independent, do your own thing, badass type of person. And I think those were largely the reasons I was reached out as well, because I think my general perception of who I am in, you know, outside of being an actor tends to now interfere with casting choices.
So, yes.
But one of the big reasons for me to do this was that this was a departure from all the other parts I'd played last year. I mean, four to be precise, gangster, upper middle class, unhappy wife, sort of another character with gray shades, and then, of course, Family Man.
This is Bypass Road, right?
Yes, where Bypass Road is where I had a semi-very antagonistic character.
Very evil.
Yeah, but yet it was still this woman who's badass, right? She's strong.
Yeah.
The adjective "strong" could be attributed to all of those characters, strong and emancipated.
Yes.
Using strength and emancipation for different purposes is notwithstanding.
Right.
So, but I think Renu's character was a departure from that. B. Also, I really enjoyed the subtext in the writing of Pathalok. The writers have done a really fantastic job of structuring the class conflict, the caste conflict, the social conflict, and overall socioeconomic stress simmering below the surface in our society. And we really haven't seen that much in content. I mean, we've seen it sort of just brushed upon as Amir Gareeb or haves and have-nots. But the layers that exist within that is something that they've really, really etched out very well. And I'm somebody who's a social observer. I'm an observer of what's happening around us in society. And for me, that really piqued my interest. And of course, the fact that it's telling a story that we really haven't seen being told. We haven't seen the story of a cop who is nondescript and, I mean, for want of a better word, loserish.
Yeah.
Why would you want to hear a loser cop story? I mean, that's really, and that's what Hathiram is at the time of the opening of this of the first episode of the series.
And you know, just watching some of it, I haven't watched the whole of it, but I plan to. You know, I get this.
Do the quick shout out on Instagram.
It's also there. Okay. Oh, good. I also get the sense I also get the sense, Gul, that it's very in tune with the things that are happening currently, aren't they? Because when you talk about Patal Lok, when you talk about the invisible people, it's really what we are seeing now, you know, right in our faces, the invisible people who are going back home. They built our cities, they built our home, they ran our homes, and suddenly we look at them and say, my God, you know, where were you?
I think that's precisely what my reference point was. At the time of reading the script, one knew that these layers in our society exist, but one yet hadn't seen them portrayed either on news networks or in fiction. I mean, the layers and layers and layers. Take, for example, the character of Chaku Singh.
Yeah.
I mean, he is a victim of caste oppression from Punjab. Now, that's not something you normally associate with in terms of caste oppression as a state. You know that Bihar, Uttar Pradesh, Jharkhand have had long violent histories of caste oppression. But Punjab, who would know? Right. I mean, I was aware of this because obviously I hail from rural Punjab and I've witnessed these things, either firsthand or secondhand happening around me. But
yeah,
the aspect of the almost invisible caste oppression in Punjab, for instance, has not been seen before.
Yeah. So suddenly you have, the migrants all over India walking back home. And, as a society, it's tearing us apart, isn't it? I mean, that empathy that some of us have and some of us don't. How important do you feel that is as a society, as an actor, as a human being, that empathy really is something we're losing every day?
I think lack of empathy and compassion had become par for the course, Kavi. We were so used to the divide, whether it was going in your car and having somebody knock at your car's window to ask for money. We'd almost gotten desensitized to the level of suffering that existed. And because of that, I think when we saw this outpouring in these numbers at a certain level, it shook us up. Not because we didn't know it existed. Yeah. We all knew it existed in the back of our minds. I mean, these are the people that come, paint your homes, go away. That's your daily wage laborer who the contractor hires to do a paint job or, move bricks from one point of one place to the other. Now, when they come out of the numbers that they do, you actually have a moment of inflection in your life.
Yeah.
I mean, and really for a lot of us, it's actually been that moment. I mean, am I going to step up and do something for these people? Can I do something firstly? At least the first point is, can I do something? The realization that, can I do something? And then of course, what you can do is, something you need to figure out. And the other realization is to conveniently look away. And looking away is what we've been doing at the traffic signals for years and years, Kaveri.
Yeah.
And can we look away this time? Can we really afford to look away is the question we need to ask ourselves.
Absolutely. Gul, you've always used your acting as a way to also engage with society in a broader way, whether it was entering politics, fighting that incredible election in 2014, which I think all of us were really rooting for you.
You're very kind.
Even if we weren't living in Chandigarh. But you've always been very political. Has it ever come in the way of your acting?
No. And there's a reason for that. Acting is one part of who I am, Kaveri. And at 40, I'm extremely comfortable saying that. Having said that, all the other parts that I am are enabled as a result of me being an actor.
Yeah.
Everything else that I do has been enabled by my acting career, but acting is one of the things that I do. And I think it's never really come in the way of my acting, so to speak, because the last 2.5 years have been the busiest years of my entire acting career. And whether people disagree with me or agree with me...
Including you becoming a mom?
Sorry, I didn't get that.
Including you becoming a mom, right?
Literally, yes. I have a 2-year-old who's with his father right now in the other room. I think it's really been the busiest time for me. And whether people agree or disagree with my views, I think there's a sense of acknowledgement that there's a balanced perspective, whichever side of the argument I may be siding at that point of time, because on a lot of issues, Kaveri, I'm extremely nationalistic when it comes to defense, when it comes to foreign policy, but on a lot of socio-economic matters, I'm left of center. So for me, it's an issue-based conversation, issue-based argument. Regardless of whether they agree or disagree with me, my liberal friends often tend to disagree with me a lot of times. My right-wing friends disagree with me most of the time. But I think there's a sense of easy truce that exists. And that is the reason that I don't think it interferes with my day-to-day functioning. I mean, I don't have people hating me. I'm not a sensationalist voicer of opinions, which are meant to to trouble and to provoke. I don't do opinions like that.
Right.
I think the important is a really, there's a need of the hour to be able to have folks who can put the center path forward without having to use provocation as a tool.
Yeah. And I think, of course, a lot of your nationalistic views come from the fact that you come from a defense family. I mean, your father is a noted army officer. And you've obviously spent much of your youth and childhood among army officers. So I think more than anyone else, you understand that.
But I also understand the jingoism that is now creeping into our nationalism.
Yes.
Because the people who are going to lay down their lives are not the folks in TV studios screaming their lungs out.
Exactly.
All the people screaming their lungs out in political rallies.
Right.
So I think, this takes me back to a very interesting conversation that that took place a couple of years on social media, which victimized this young lady called Gurmehar Kaur.
Yes.
There's right. Nobody other than the armed forces who want peace.
Yeah.
I mean, if there's somebody that wants peace the world over, it's the armed forces, because they've actually paid the price. I come from a third generation armed forces family. My grandfather has fought in the Second World War. My father's brother has fought in all the post-independence wars. My father has fought, he's been commissioned. He was commissioned in 68, so he's fought whatever came his way.
Yeah.
From then, my in-laws come from three generations of armed forces. So the thing is, we know the price it takes to be paying to keep this jingoism fed. And a lot of what we see is rhetoric. And challenging as it is, the rhetoric sometimes fuels policy. And that's not how it should be covered, in my opinion.
Yeah. So, when you are in Bollywood, which is also, I think, to a certain extent, becoming part of this manufacturing of nationalism and a certain amount of jingoism, does it worry you sometimes that we are headed towards entertainment, which is really sometimes becoming like propaganda?
So, I'm just going to open the box for a second here.
Yeah.
We know what the American army did with its napalm bombing in Vietnam. And after My Lai, the transgressions committed by the American army came to light. We saw within the next 2 decades, an incredible amount of movies coming out of Hollywood that pumped up the image of the US Army, almost whitewash what they had done in Vietnam. Now, I'm not saying the Indian Army is like the American Army. We do not have a policy of collateral damage. We do not do HR violations, but there will be exceptions. But when we build a narrative where everything is okay, where it's where it's okay to break the law one time, just because it happens to fulfill bloodlust, then you are actually encouraging a culture of breaking the laws. I mean, the Indian Army is one of those few armies that have the best human rights record in the world. I mean, compared with armies that have been fighting insurgency, whether it's the Sri Lankan Army, which has the worst human rights record, particularly the last offensive against the LTTE,
yes.
For that matter. The anti-insurgency forces operating in Afghanistan and Iraq, and those are only coming to light now through congressional hearings based movies that are now beginning to see. So the army has a stellar record in upholding the law, the army laws, the codes of conduct that are within the Indian Army. Now we are beginning to see a certain lionization of acts that are strictly within the code of conduct. And then you have everybody from godmen to political leaders justifying that, oh, you know what, but you're not terrorists. You don't know what it's like to be there. What distinguishes us from terrorists is that we follow the law.
Yeah.
And we follow the code, the codified standard operating procedures. I mean, we're going very, very in depth, and I sort of want to kind of come back out for a second. But what I'm going to say is we've seen this happen before, Kaveri, in Hollywood, where for 25 years, in fact, the whole glamorization of the armed forces in the United States actually began right after Vietnam.
Yeah, I mean, you remember Born on the 4th of July and a whole host of huge movies which talked about the Vietnam vet as this, this
hero,
survivor, PTSD. Yeah, the hero.
And even the man who
That's
was
actually a fascinating in. Into
Sorry, I lost you there for a second.
Kaveri, can you hear? I said in a way that's a very interesting insight into, yes, I can. It's a very interesting insight into what's going on in Bollywood currently as well, isn't it?
I think it's also convenient. You see, that's the kind of a lot, anything to do with the armed forces needs a lot of coordination with MOD. So you cannot film anything, any piece of content which has the armed forces being depicted without a lot of liaisoning with the MOD. And since this government has put the army on a sort of a pedestal when convenient, and sort of made its equivalence with nationalism as support for the army, I think anything that has content which surrounds the armed forces in general will find favor, because it kind of goes with the flow of what this government wants to see itself being identified as and with. And nothing's wrong with that. I mean, as long as we encourage the belief that the armed forces always do the right thing, even when faced with a choice where the wrong thing is an easier choice. So as long as we uphold the beliefs of the institution, the ethos of the institution, I don't think it's a bad thing, Kavi.
Right. You know, when you look around you currently, do you feel that you want to give politics another shot, Kul?
I think absolutely. I feel I'd be just another armchair activist if I didn't go out there and do what I feel I should be doing. So I definitely would. I remain a deeply political person. So would I give politics a shot? I'm doing politics morning to evening. I mean, polis is what the word politics is derived from in Latin, or Greek. But would I be partaking in electoral politics?
Yeah.
Is something that I think only time will reveal. I mean, I have a small child, and each day is a new challenge, including during the lockdown. So I feel I'm deeply political as a human being, and I will continue to be political and involved in politics. Electoral politics also is one part of it, and I wouldn't say no for sure. Yeah. I mean, I wouldn't say no at all to that.
But let's come back a little to your, entertainment career. The roles being offered to you are finally sort of catching up with you, which were again so unconventional at that time, right? So it seems that the entertainment industry is finally caught up with you rather than the other way around, right?
Well, that's flattering for you to say, Kaveri. Thank you for that. I just think it's also got to do with the OTT platform, especially the top of the pyramid ones like Amazon Prime Video, which have huge number of data points on the kind of viewer behavior that there is out there. So if Cambridge Analytica had 5,000 data points on your political behavior, there's an equivalent number of data points that OTTs have on our viewing behavior. I mean, after every time you view something, you are giving them a data point, if not more. Right? For every ad you consume, every preview you watch, every trailer you watch and then not decide to watch the main film. So what's happened is they've been able to open the box which constrained theatrical films of a certain scale, because it had to cater to a vast majority of people in terms of, I mean, for want of a better example, or terminology, let's call it the lowest common denominator.
Yeah.
It needed to cater to the lowest common denominator in order to guarantee somewhat a return on investment. My light's gone out. So I have a light at home, lots of Instagram lives, but its battery is now, after 30 lives that I've done over the course of the lockdown, it's beginning to die a bit. So I think what we're seeing is that the lowest common denominator led formula, which dictated choice of subject, which dictated casting choices, are now being opened. So because unconventional, we'll take this call for 1 second. Hello, I'm on a live. Can I call you back? Okay, bye. So these are the choices that earlier dictated casting and subject, that dictated theatrical films, are now being sort of open, the box is being opened, and you're seeing more unconventional stories being told with different treatment and as much production value, in fact.
Yeah.
And also the casting choices are now more linked to suitability of the character.
Right.
So which is why we're seeing And then because you have these incredible artificial intelligence backed algorithms that read data points, you know what Kaveri would like and what Gul would like, and they would serve it to you on a platter. And you'd be consuming it.
So if Kaveri likes Gul, she'll watch more of her.
Come again?
I said if Kaveri likes Gul, she'll watch much more of
her. I hope so. I do hope so.
No, but it also means has the entertainment industry started perceiving you differently, Gul? Were you perceived as too urbane, too chic, not exactly your typical Bollywood heroine? Was there ever that idea?
I think at some level, I think there was a sense of she's different always.
Yeah.
But I don't think that was really a bad thing. I mean, because unless and until you're different, you're replaceable.
Yeah, exactly.
So I think that's one. And like I said earlier, everything that I do apart from acting has also added to the way I'm perceived.
Yeah.
And that is now beginning to influence casting choices. Which also restricts me, I suppose, at some level. I would say if I can get some better light and maybe you meet my two dogs who are sitting here. Yeah, much better.
Really? So, what are their names?
Their names are Gina and Vegas. Both are beagles. And one of them has been scratching and scratching and scratching, and therefore, no luck. I thought it'll get better, but it hasn't.
But it's all right. It's not too bad.
I'm in silhouette now.
But it's okay. You still look lovely, so it's fine. So, was there a sense that. Can you see them?
Come here. I'm trying to get one of them here. Come here. Good girl. Come here. There she is. Say hello to Gina.
Oh, so cute. Wow. Does it need to go to a vet? Is it scratching herself too much?
That's the other one who's wearing the Elizabeth collar, who I'm not getting because she doesn't need to go to a vet. I think I'm going to come back here, Kaveri. Sorry. Okay. She's okay. She's sort of 9 years old and has an obsessive compulsive disorder where she likes to scratch herself. So I think once...
That's like us when we grow old, really.
She's there. She's there already. She's 70.
So it's just that it's a really good time for you to be in entertainment, isn't it? The older you're getting, the better your paths are, isn't it? I mean, who would have thought?
Actually, you're right. I also think it's because I'm now 41 and I have lots of files in my hard disk about various experiences and emotions. And in fact, in Patal Lok, one question that I got asked was very often during the course of interviews is, how are you able to play the vulnerability that's associated with my character?
Yeah.
And my answer to that is, well, I have faced 20 years of life.
Yeah.
And there are lots of experiences that I have which are stored away. And as an actor, you just pull out the file, tweak it a little bit. You no longer have to imagine what it would feel like to be vulnerable because you've probably been through that at some point of time in your life. So I feel acting as a role, as a job has become more effortless.
Yeah.
Or maybe I've surrendered to the craft. I don't know.
Right.
So, I mean, for instance, working with Jaideep has been it's really been incredible. He's such a fine actor. Yeah. And... going back to the script, it's written so well. And the production design is what it is. So as you've seen, the episodes that I'm in, I mean, our world, is such once you're in there, dressed the way I'm dressed.
Yeah.
So, I'm already on set with literally 80% of my work done, Kaveri.
Right.
You put me in that outfit, you put a stellar actor like Jaideep in the frame with me. There's this house that, you just become a part of.
Yeah.
Literally like 80% of my work is done when I step on set.
Yeah. And also, the kind of roles you're getting now, you've already, I believe, shot Family Man season 2, or are you going...
I can neither confirm or deny that.
Okay. We have a question from Pulkit Bade to you, Gul. Ask Gul one thing she would have asked Arvind Kejriwal to do differently in his handling of COVID-19 in Delhi. Cheeky question.
Well, I think essentially, I mean, I'm actually really struggling with an answer out there. Because of two reasons, and they're very honest ones. One is I'm barely able to catch up with the news.
Yeah.
For Pulkit, I don't know if you were there when I said this. I have a two-year-old child, two dogs and a house, and I don't get to the news. So the news that I get is literally from my husband reading his news. I don't even get to Twitter these days, Kaveri. There's just no bandwidth. And, you know, I literally get to my phone for 10 minutes a day, and that's usually spent catching up with like 150 odd WhatsApp messages.
Of course.
So I honestly, if you were to ask me what have they done, what haven't they done, I wouldn't be able to give an educated answer. I don't know enough about the subject. I do not know about the specifics of the handling. I do know about the specifics of the handling of Mumbai, which is where I'm locked up, because it affects me on a day-to-day basis. But currently, Pulkit, I just don't have the bandwidth to keep up with anything beyond my existing life, which involves running after my two-year-old child who likes to throw things from my 8th floor house on the ground, put the iPad under the dogs, or try and throw my phone in the toilet. So literally, I'm running after him all day long.
How has life in the lockdown been, Gul? Has it taught you more patience than you had, or has it made you tear your hair out? What's it been like?
So the first couple weeks, Kaveri, was me barely being able to keep my head above the water.
Right.
There was just so much that needed to be done.
Yeah.
And there was work at home, and then there was work from home.
Right.
And I wouldn't even get to the work from home part. I would have a to-do list for the day. It's lying on my desk somewhere, and which is a dining table. And I would go to bed frustrated, you know, 18 hours later, because I hadn't gotten to any of it. And my days were really long, because my son was in the habit of waking up at 5:36.
Oh, no.
And now all of that has gotten sort of changed, because I've relaxed a lot of the things I was imposing, because he used to wake up at 6, have breakfast by 8, and all of that. I used to go to school, play school. So I think the first couple of weeks had me really struggling to keep my head above the water.
Right.
And but by the third week, I began to come, you know, sort of get into a bit of a rhythm. And what really helped me was starting my series of Instagram lives, which would be every day at 12 o'clock.
Right.
So then I was forced to finish a chunk of, we were forced, my husband and I, were forced to finish a chunk of the household chores by then.
Right.
So I could, you know, I could sit and do this while my husband and my son sat in the, you know, in the other room doing, playing and stuff. And then I would dive into lunch and then put my son for his afternoon nap and stuff. But what's happened over the last couple of weeks is that I've gotten better at it.
Yeah.
I've become more efficient. So I've also, I mean, one of the positive benefits is I'm fitter. So I know that I have less time. So I see each day as a challenge, and I try and see where I'm going to exercise and what I'm going to do. So I'm eating better because I'm cooking all the food. I'm exercising smartly because I have very little time. So,
yeah.
And our son is like that relay baton, which my husband and I pass to each other. So the person who's with the child at the time can't really do anything. I mean, you have two boys, right?
Yeah. Yes. How do you remember? Wow.
Oh, because I was reading your book.
Oh, okay. Yes. Thank you. Thank you for reading that. But really, you know, I can tell you it never gets better, Gul. It just
don't say that. Please don't say that. I'll cry right now.
No, but I mean, it's also something that, you know, one learns to take in one stride, really. And
I think that's where I've come at, Kaveri. Yeah. I've learned to adapt. And I also, you know, back 20 years ago, when I first set up house as an independent woman, I used to live in Delhi.
Right.
Yeah. Everything myself. Not because I couldn't, I couldn't afford or get help. It's just that I thought I was superwoman. And I used to clean, I used to wash clothes, I used to cook, I used to do everything. And then slowly, as I got busy, I began delegating.
Yeah.
And now it's back to being able to do everything that I was once doing. And, you know, I actually realized that all of us women are superwomen.
Yeah.
We really have dogs come and put her hair in my nose.
I know, it's very irritating.
I've realized that everything that I do, and all of us women do, is something that we have an infinite capacity for. And it's the attitude with which you approach it. If you approach it as this, oh my God, now I have to do this, then it's going to be a pain.
Right.
So to answer your question, yes, I've gotten a lot better at it. And I'm also imagining that this isn't a temporary phase. Oh, better light, thank you. I'm also imagining that this is not a temporary phase, Kavin. What we are seeing is a trailer of the new normal.
Yes.
And I don't see us getting back to where we were. Like a lot of folks I speak with, oh, you know, I can't wait for things to go back to the way they were.
Yeah.
I'm not seeing this going away for a year.
Yeah.
I mean, for us to resume our old life, I don't know if that life's coming back. The Spanish flu is the closest reference to what this is like. This is not like SARS. It's not like H1N1.
Yeah.
So what I've learned is self-reliance. What I've learned is better planning of my day. What I've learned is to be more patient. And I've also learned to live with a lot less. Like I have 15 tops out of like a few hundred that I have used, and I put them, and then I put them in a pile, take out the bottom one, and then second last, and third last, and third. And so I've literally lived in 15 tops. I like to get into a top when I'm working because it doesn't feel like work otherwise. It's not a t-shirt. So 15 tops and, you know, one pair of jeans. And then when work is over, I throw on a pair of pajamas or shorts and finish stuff. I need a lot less. And I'm actually feeling a lot of gratitude and a sense of abundance.
Yeah.
That we are very, very privileged to have.
Absolutely.
Abundance in the Deepak Chopra-esque context.
I think, Gul, you're going to be a guru ma soon.
Oh, no.
One of the last questions I want to ask you, Gul, is that, you know, you talked about this new normal. The biggest question is in the entertainment industry is when do we start shooting again? And actors are really at the front line because you're not going to be able to use PPE while you're in a scene, you know, and you have to be in close proximity with your co-actors, you know, no matter what. So the actors will have to actually bear the brunt of all our fears and our, suspicions. So how are you preparing for that? Because shooting will begin at some point.
I'm guessing post-monsoon, Kaveri.
Yeah.
Because I have a feeling this is going to get worse before it gets better.
Yes.
And we're going to see temperatures drop in the monsoon. Gispiri, I mean, sometimes temperatures drop to as little as 24 and 25 degrees.
Right.
When it's raining, which by Bombay standards is pretty cool. So I don't see shoot with large number of people on set resuming before September.
Yeah.
And I mean, my outlook on the fact that we'll be at the forefront is a bit philosophical, really. I think, again, coming from a generation of, you know, third generation armed forces family, it's part of the job. So you just do it. It's like, it's really something that you, I mean, if you have the luxury of not doing a particular project because you feel, oh, you know what, I can sit this one out, then you sit it out. But if you don't have that luxury of choice, then you just go about it and, you know, there's a probability you'll get shot.
Yeah.
A small probability because more people make it back than those who don't.
Yeah.
In war. And then you just hope for the best.
Right.
So, and that's the only way to look at it. I mean, you know, I mean, this is the same. I remember on right after Janta curfew, my husband was on standby. He's a pilot.
Yeah.
And the Janta curfew looked like, you know, the lockdown was imminent.
Right.
And both of us didn't expect that he'd get pulled out on that standby on that Monday morning. He, in fact, got pulled out Sunday midnight, right. Like literally, and for a 3-day pattern, which took him all over the country and would have brought him back Wednesday night if we hadn't shut down the airspace on Tuesday night.
Right.
And that happened on 23rd or 24th. And by then, COVID had actually been around because as people who operate planes and in fact, cabin crew more than them, they're actually at the front line because this virus is imported.
Absolutely.
It's
yeah.
coming from overseas. So one just takes a, you know, I remember, he did a Middle East flight sometime in the first week of March when already the panic was beginning to spread. And his position was, you know, what if I was in the army, like our dads?
Yeah.
Would I have a choice? No. So that's my view of the whole thing. You know, if I have the luxury of sitting it out, maybe I'll, you know, take that position. But at that point of time, when that call comes and when I'm privileged enough to be considered for work and cast and, you know, hired.
Yeah.
I think I should just go do it like our dads have been to war.
And such good work. I mean, that's also attractive, isn't it? You want to be part of entertainment that is interesting and defining and, you know, making some sort of move towards a different kind of entertainment, isn't
yes.
it? Yes. My very last question to you, Gul, you're such an outdoors person. Your mobiles and your flights and your travel around everywhere. How are you? Are you going stir crazy just being inside your home?
Frankly, I don't have the time to think about going crazy. I really don't have the time. I know. So my husband really, really is one of those quintessential, really sharing the load kind of people. In fact, he does more than his share.
Lucky you.
I'm privileged. I'm indeed very, very grateful. But despite that, I'm literally at it all day long. So I don't really have time to think about all that. But I mean, I have a short sort of an answer for what I'm looking forward to. I'm looking forward to exploring more of India.
Yeah.
I don't see myself stepping out of the country for 2 years.
Right. I agree.
And I want to see all those places, lesser explored places, which will enforce social distancing by default. And I'm looking forward to seeing more of mountains that I haven't seen. I haven't been to the Northeast as much. So my next destination is Gangtok, as and when I can visit.
Wonderful. So Gangtok, Gul is coming your way. Thank you so much, Gul, for talking to us. It was really a pleasure and all the very best. I look forward to very, very interesting work from you.
Thank you, Kaveri. And thank you for asking such lovely questions and saying such fine things about me. Thank you. I really appreciate it.
Thank you so much. Take care.
Bye. Thank you. Bye-bye.